All right, good to see everybody here tonight. Welcome to the Wednesday night service, and good to see you in church tonight. Let's start by singing together 327. Springs of living water, I thirsted in the barren land of sin and shame. 327, once you have it, let's stand together to sing. Springs of living water, Brother Bob.
I thirsted in the barren land of sin and shame, and nothing satisfying there I found. But to the blessed cross of Christ one day I came, where springs of living water did abound. Drinking at the springs of living water, happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water, oh, wonderful and bountiful supply. How sweet the living water from the hills of God. It makes me glad and happy all the way. Now glory, grace, and blessing mark the path I've trod. I'm shouting hallelujah every day. I'm drinking at the springs of living water. Happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water, oh, wonderful and bountiful supply. Oh, sinner, won't you come today to Calvary? A fountain there is flowing deep and wide. The Savior now invites you to the water free, where thirsting spirits can be satisfied. Drinking at the springs of living water, happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water, oh, wonderful and bountiful supply.
All right, good singing tonight. Good to see everybody here in church. Diane Stiltner got here. How about that? From the hospital bed to the church pew, amen. And good to see you, Diane. I'm glad you made it. Good to have Yoder's back, and Brother Dave's here. They had a good missions conference down in Maryland, and they're back with us. So good to see you home. And these folks right here, you are the missionaries staying up in our apartment, are you not? Bob and Kathy Cook, good to have you folks here. Good to see you again, and thanks for being in church tonight. And then the Richardson family is here, and Cindy was here on Sunday, and she brought the rest of her family with her tonight. And but they're in for the service for Grandpa, and at viewing today. The service is tomorrow at 1 p.m. at Heritage. I think they are having families receiving guests from like 11:30 to 12:30, I think, and then the service is at 1, is what I understand. So. Get an opportunity to go tomorrow. I know you'll be blessed. I'm looking forward to that service tomorrow. And great to see them. Of course, he pastors the Cross Ridge Baptist Church of Minnie, Kentucky. And you are getting ready to celebrate 9 years there. Wow, it's amazing. And they were one of our first new missionaries that we took on when I first came here. First missions conference, I think, in 2006. Needed songbooks, I remember that, and we got you 50 songbooks and sent them down there, and that's what a great thing. And now, boy, they're doing just a wonderful, got a solid church built there and ministering to the community, and it's an exciting place. I love to get your reports every week about what God's doing. Appreciate you sending those to us, and great to have them here. You're going to hear from those girls in a little bit. They're not going to be here and not sing for us, okay? And so we're looking forward to hearing them sing here in just a few minutes. But let's open with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you for the opportunity to be in church tonight. And Lord, thank you so much for the friends and guests, the visitors, our loved ones that are here with us. And Father, we simply bow before you and ask you to control the service here this evening. Lord, you knew exactly who would be present. You know exactly how this service ought to go. And Father, we just want to follow your leading and be in the perfect will of God as we go through this service tonight. And so, Lord, we bow before you and ask you to use the music, use the testimonies, use the Bible study, use in each one of our lives to fashion us and make us more like Christ because we were here tonight. Thank you for each one who's made the effort to be in church here this evening. Lord, my prayer tonight would be that we could leave in just a little bit saying, it sure was good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. And so minister to us as only you can. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Turn with me, if you would, to number 78 in your hymnal, 78. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. When we all get to heaven, on that first together.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
On that third,
let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Tonight's letter is from Brother Fielder with Worldview Ministries. Worldview associate Sam Moss had visited the Mahdi subregion several times for the purpose of informing the pastors there about our Bible translation project for their language. He also invited them to attend our recent two-day pastors conference. On the 7th of April, just a few hours after we arrived in Arua, Uganda, a bus pulled up and 34 Mahdi pastors got off. They came from 5 hours away to attend the conference. We had an exciting 2 days with them. Pastor Bill Fennell, missionary Sam Moss, and I had several opportunities to preach. On Saturday afternoon, I took the time to focus on our translation project with the pastors. I wanted them to know why we were translating into their language and how we were going to do it. After I explained that we would be translating from the original language, Greek, their response was enthusiastic, clapping and shouting. Then, after I explained that we follow a literal translation philosophy as opposed to a dynamic equivalent one, their response was the same, rejoicing and praising God. They were fired up. It was an exciting meeting, to say the least. On Sunday evening, we had the privilege of participating in the ordination of three pastors. One of these men, Izama David, is one of our Bible translators. The Sunday morning service was dedicated to the launching of the Mahdi Project. I preached a sermon on the power of the Word of God. At the end of the service, our five men came forward and we dedicated the project to the glory of God and prayed for the men as they labor in this effort for the next few years. Our five translators are spirit-filled men who are passionate about this work. I would love to bring them all to the USA and let you all meet them. It is obvious that God has given us some really good men to work with. Please pray for them and for the translation of God's word. My family and I are traveling to Texas, where I will be preaching a missions conference starting on Sunday. Just a few minutes ago, on I-44 West in central Missouri, we ran out of gas. Believe it or not, the vehicle shut off just as we were approaching an exit. We coasted up the ramp, ran the stop sign, turned left, crossed the overpass, and then turned left into a gas station and rolled right up to the gas pump. Wow, thank the Lord. May God bless you. Thank you for your continued support and prayers for Worldview Ministries. Exalting the Lord, Ken Fielder.
If I ever run out of gas, I want to be with him. That's who I want to be with. Amen. That's great. Great. How exciting. When you grew up like we've grown up and you've always had a Bible, you can't appreciate. We don't really even comprehend what it's like to be from another country, another language, and somebody come tell you, we're going to put the Bible in your language. Wow. How exciting that must be for those pastors. And that's a wonderful, wonderful report. All right, and that's where the conference there that they had that, Sam Moss is the missionary that John and Emily Combest are with. All right, Emily Moreland Combest. And so that's where they're serving for these 9 months. So they were part of that meeting down there as well. So that was exciting. All right. Girls, come on up and get ready, okay? While you're coming up, listen carefully. Try to listen and watch them come up and get ready at the same time. And the schedule tomorrow night, pray for the RU Inside down at the CRC prison. And great week there last week with 17 men saved. And then, of course, Friday night, RU right here. Saturday morning with the out at London for the RU Inside. And then, of course, soul winning and bus visitation at 10 a.m. right here. Let's keep getting the flyers out for the country fair. And got a call from a couple stores today that are donating and helping us out with that. So just keep it going, all right? Sign them up. Flyers are on the table in the conference room. Sign up, and let's keep getting them out there. Remember, we got to have 1,000 a day. Get 20,000 by the 21st of May. So let's keep after it, and let's enjoy some good singing right now from the Richardson girls.
Can't you see that we're about to die? This boat we're on is surely going under. Save us now, his disciples cry. So Jesus rose to stand against the tempest, knowing his disciples had no faith. Just to prove that he was still the master, he spoke and the winds and seas obeyed. He'd still been God, even if he never fought the storm or the raging sea. He'd still been God, even if he never made the blinded eyes to see. He'd still been God, even if he never brought the crippled man to his feet. It's not about what he did, it's all about who he is. 'Cause even if he never done another single miracle, Jesus would have still been God.
Mary was his loving earthly mother. She understood the purpose of her son.
Ever since the angel came and told her, this child is the blessed Son of God. So when she'd see the people gathered round him, watching for a miracle to prove that he would be the one and great Messiah,
she just smiled,
'cause she obeyed, he knew. He'd still been God, even if he never fought the storm or the raging sea. He'd still been God, even if he never made the blinded eyes to see. He'd still been God, even if he never brought the crippled man to his feet. It's not about what he did, it's all about who he is. 'Cause even if he never done another single miracle, Jesus would've still been God.
He'd have still been God, even if he never fought the storm or the raging sea. He'd still been God, even if he never made the blinded eyes to see. He'd still been God, even if he never brought the crippled man to his feet.
It's not about what he did, it's all about who he is. 'Cause even if he never done another single miracle, Jesus would have still been God.
It's not about what he did.
It's all about who he is. He is. 'Cause even if he never done another single miracle, Jesus would have still been God. 'Cause even if he never done another single miracle, Jesus would have still been
God.
I've been blessed with many things. God's been good too.
I have family and friends who share in all I do. But if I lose it all and I'm left with nothing, if I have the Lord, I know I'll make it through. He's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. He's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. You see, there's nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. Oh, he's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. You may have tried a lot of things to find real happiness, but if you look very long, you know that it cannot be found until you find the Lord and you know the power of His Spirit. He'll be your reason to live, and He'll never, never let you down. He's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. He's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. You see, there's nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. Oh, he's the only reason I live, but oh, what a reason. You see, there's nothing in this world that's worth living for. It will only leave you empty and longing for more. Oh, he's the only reason I live. Oh, he's the only reason I live. But oh, what a reason.
I don't know.
Every morning when I wake to see the sun, I can't help but think about my Lord and all the things He's done. He meets my every need. You know He's been so good to me, and I can't help but praise the Lord for all He's done.
For all He's done, I'm gonna lift my hands and praise Him.
For all He's done,
begun. And I can't help but praise the Lord for all he's done. There are many things that I could praise God for. And if I started now until I died, there'd still be many more. If I could mention only one, I'd have to thank him for his son. Now that's enough to praise the Lord for all he's done. For all he's done. I'm gonna lift my hands and praise him for all he's done. I'm gonna live my life to please him, even though I don't deserve to live. My life has just begun, and I can't help but praise the Lord for all he's done. For all he's done. I'm gonna lift my hands and praise him for all he's done. I'm gonna live my life to please him, even though I don't deserve to live. My life has just begun, and I can't help but praise the Lord. I can't help but praise the Lord.
Outstanding. Wow. I like that a lot. And that's great. Wonderful. Thank you so much for singing for us. We really appreciate that. If you, you know, and these are folks who 3 days ago just found out their grandpa went to heaven. And this is a very close family on both sides, both Richardson side and the Hamby side. They're a very close family. Grandpa was a big influence in the family for good and for God. If you want to see a testimony and you want to see how people handle the homegoing of someone whom they love, you just watch the Richardsons and how they're handling that and the grace of God upon their life. And praise the Lord for that. Thank you so much. Great to see you. And what a blessing. Well, listen, let's all sing together. We won't sound that good, but we'll do the best we can, all right? Take a songbook and let's sing number 228, He Hideth My Soul. 228. Let's stand together and sing it, all right?
A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. He taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength at my name. He in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And with his hand. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. With numberless blessings, each moment he crowns, and filled with his fullness divine. I sing in my rapture, oh glory to God, for such the Redeemer as mine. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. Let's sing that last together. 228, if you need it. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise. Him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with a million on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand and covers me there with his hand.
Everybody said? Amen. Be seated if you will. Great singing tonight, and just I tell you, when you're in church and you sing like that, you just put your vote in for let's make sure we don't give up Wednesday night church. Amen. And I love Wednesday night services. And we're going to take the offering tonight. First Wednesday night of the month goes to Brother Yoder. Brother Yoder told me just now, shaking hands, he got his tickets today to go to Armenia. Brother Moreland's already flying out in May and be there for 3 months. And Brother Yoder will go over and be part of the pastor's conference. And I think he's real close to it. He got a great deal on his tickets, $1,169 or something like that, to fly there and back. Round trip's good. And coming back home afterwards, and we We're close to that amount, I know, and but let's just not get him there with nothing in his pocket. Let's make sure we take care of that. And he has a little bit of money when he gets there to take care of himself. And so that's what the offering will go towards tonight, as usual, first Wednesday night of the month, all right? Let's pray, and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering this evening. Brother Wallace, I'd like you to lead us in prayer, if you would, please.
Let's pray. Father, we do even now pray for the safety, and that you would make Brother Yoder and Brother Moreland's path straight and safe as they travel. And Lord, I just ask that you would even now start blessing the their ways, and Lord, give them the right thoughts, and Lord, may this be a prosperous travel for them. And Lord, we expect to hear great things from you and from them. Father, I do pray that you bless this service now as Pastor opens up your word and teaches your word. Lord, I pray that our spirit will be right, and that Lord will have an eagerness to want to learn more about you. And Father, I do pray that you would bless this offering now to the nourishment of our bodies. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Take your Bible this evening, if you would. Go to 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4, please. 1 Peter chapter 4. For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that has suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but to the will of God. For the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles, when we walked in lasciviousness, lusts, excess of wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable idolatries, wherein they think it strange that ye run not with them to the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you, who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead. Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture now this evening. And Father, as we continue our studies here on this subject of separation, I pray, God, that you would guide us and lead us again and help us to rightly divide the word of truth, and Spirit of God be the master teacher. And Lord, I pray you'd minister to each and every heart as only you can. And Father, I pray that you would open our understanding as we look into your word, and that your word would be the authority in our life that you desire it to be. And that, Lord, we would live the truths that we learn. And Father, that we truly would be separate from this world and separate unto our God, that we might be vessels of honor unto you. And as the girls sang tonight, that we would be pleasing in your sight, and that you would be the reason that we live. Now, Father, bless our time in your word, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. According to 1 Peter 4 and verse 2, we're not to live the rest of our time in the flesh, once we receive Christ as our Savior, we're not living the rest of our time in the flesh to the lusts of men, to the desires of not only what we want, what we think, or what we feel, or but what others want, or what others think, or what others feel. We have a different standard by which we live once we come to know Christ as our Savior. And that standard is the will of God. Now, what does God want me to do? How does God want me to live? What does God want me to do? When we lived outside of Christ, that's what someone is who isn't saved. You're outside of Christ. And if you're outside of Christ, then, my friend, you are in the world. And we do whatever the world does. You're just like, listen, nothing in the world should surprise us that they what happens or what they do. Because, you know, it's like I said a few weeks ago, you can't tell, you know, sinners not to sin. Sinners is what sinners do. Sin is what sinners do. Amen? And so that's okay. And that's the way we lived outside of Christ. But once you're in Christ, once you receive Christ your Savior, now you're a new creature. Those old things are passed away and all things are to become new. And what's that mean? Now I live after the will of God. Now, well, how do I know what God wants? Do I wear a bracelet that says WWJD? Is that the secret? No, that's not the secret. What's the secret? God gave us a book. And God says, I gave you a book that you can follow. I gave you, here's my will. Here's how I want you to conduct your life. This is the manual that we use to see how God wants us to live. The will of God is always in the Word of God. And so he says here in 1 Peter 4 that you not only, you live to the will of God. Now he talks about our past life in verse 3. The past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles. That's just the will of folks who don't know God. And notice it says we walked in lasciviousness. Lasciviousness is shameless conduct. Lasciviousness is no restraint. Okay? It means whatever you want to do, you do it. I can't tell you that you shouldn't do that. And if somebody, and so there's no restraint at all. Listen, God said that's how you lived before you were saved. That's not how you live after you're saved. Okay, this is describing someone who lives a life without Christ or outside of Christ. Lasciviousness, shameless conduct, no restraint. Lusts are simply strong desires. Okay, it's living by emotions. It's living by feeling. If I feel good, it's going to be a good day. If I feel bad, I'm going to make everybody miserable today. Just the way it is, deal with it. You see, because we live by emotions and we live by feelings. That's living according to your lusts. Okay, whatever I want, whatever I think, whatever I do, that's what I'm going to do. Okay, so then it says excess of wine. That literally, it's the bubbling of the wine. It's fermented beverages. It's living with alcohol. We're going to talk about that a little bit later in the lesson. Then it says revelings. Revelings is a word that means carousing as a result of drunkenness. The word literally is komos. We get our word chaos from it. Okay, it's just chaos and carousing as a result of drunkenness, alcohol. Then it says banquetings. That's, again, drinking and eating, partying, just going from one party to another. Okay, then abominable idolatries. Abominable idolatries are sins of the mind against God. Become idolaters. And by the way, how do you become an idolater of your mind? You make a God up in your mind that is not the God of the Bible. There are a lot of people like that. And by the way, there are some even saved people like that. How do you know that? Because you know what they say? Well, I don't think God would do something like that. Did you know it really doesn't matter what you think or what I think? It matters what God says. And this is the God of the Bible. And you have to make sure that the God that you have in your mind is the God that's the God of the Bible. And that it's one and the same. Otherwise, you have an idol set up. Now, notice it says in verse 4, so they, who's they? The people of verse 3. They think it strange that ye run not with them. Run means running alongside the same course. They think it strange that you won't run along the same course with them, okay, in their excess of riot. Then that, so what will they do? Speak evil of you. Okay, In fact, I remember reading somewhere in the Bible, it says, woe unto you when all men speak well of you. You know, you tell a lot. And listen, Bible Christianity has never been popular with the world. Is this on? Bible Christianity has never been popular with the world. This Christianity that wants to be embraced by the world and everybody think, oh, you're okay, or you're cool, you're cool, man, you're all right. That kind of Christianity is foreign to the Bible. The reason that it's not being spoken evil of is we are running along the same course as they are. Latest Barna poll that does a lot of polling among born-again Christians and what they call evangelicals will tell you that in entertainment and in music and in play, the way that people use their spare time, the programs they watch on television, they say there is no difference between those who say they are born-again Christians and those who say they do not know Christ. Because we're running along the same path. And God says it shouldn't be that way. Because he reminds us, what verse 5 is very important. What does it say? Who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead. We're going to give an account one day for how we live. This idea of separation, and we've talked about this before in the past lessons. We're not talking about whether this is going to mean whether you're going to heaven or hell. Whether you go to heaven or hell is based on what you do with Jesus Christ. You receive him as your Savior and you trust him alone as your Savior, you'll go to heaven. But we talked about Sunday, ties in with these lessons on Wednesday night. We talked about Sunday how, you know, we want a Savior from hell, but we don't want a Savior from our sins. But he sent Jesus to be a Savior from our sins. And to make sure that we understand, Jesus Christ has the power to allow. Listen, you can't live the life we're going to describe, and you can't live the separated life without Jesus Christ. You'll get frustrated, and you'll get flustered, and you'll get defeated, and you'll get discouraged, because you can't do it on your own. It's not willpower. It's got to be by God's power. And he desires that for us. Remember, he says, come out from among them, and he said, I will receive you, and I'll be a father unto you, and you can be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord. Doesn't mean that he isn't your father. There's one thing to say, that guy is my father, but can he be a father to you? You gave me, hear me, remember, use the illustration about my brother who grew up, and my brother went a different way than I did. And I remember clearly when my dad told me your brother called, and my brother had a family, a wife, and two children, and I remember him calling up and saying, hey, when you guys have family get-togethers, I don't want to come. I don't want to be involved. I got my own life, going my own way, and alcohol included, and tobacco included, and just didn't want to be around anything like that, where he'd get asked, did you go to church? Are you going to go to church? What's going on in your life? And he just stayed away. Does that mean my dad was not his father anymore? Oh, no, he's still his father. But he couldn't be a father to him. You know why? Because he wouldn't come out and be separate. And he wouldn't come to my dad. And so I had the same father, but he could be a father to me. Because I came out from among them and been separate, and he could receive me. You see? That's the only difference it is. And the word there, receive, means embrace. I can embrace you. Okay? You're as close to God as you want to be. You're as close to God as you want to be. You draw nigh to me, God says, and I will draw nigh to you. You're as close to God as you want to be, and you're as close to God as you desire to be close to him and away from the things of the world. Because friendship with the world is enmity with God. Okay? And so we're going to talk a little bit specifically about some areas of separation tonight. We're living according to the will of God. We're living according to what God says. So it's not a matter of, well, I just don't believe you have to, or I don't think you have to do that, or I don't see what's so wrong. Well, take what I don't see or what I don't think out of the equation and just say whatever God's word says. That's the final authority. And get my thoughts out of it. I'm not here to, listen, you and I are not here to determine right or wrong. We're not here to determine good or evil. You know why? God already did that. We just have to obey what he says. And so that's what we're going to look at tonight. Under the control of the will of God, the word of God. About what? Number one is alcohol. Alcohol. You would think, oh, preacher, everybody's against alcohol. You'd be surprised. You'd be surprised how many folks in these days. In fact, turn to Proverbs 20. And while you're turning back there, I'll tell you, Brother Xavier was just sharing with me. I think Brother Xavier met a fella. I don't remember all the details, but he met him, and the fella professed to be a Christian and told him what church he went to and such. And he happened to run into him at Kroger's a little while later. And you know, he noticed in the guy's cart a bottle of wine. You know, well, you know, you just think the best. Maybe somebody's got an illness or something, you know. And he ran in a few weeks later, and it wasn't wine in the cart anymore. It was 6-pack or 12-pack of beer. Now, wait a minute. There's a fellow who says he knows Christ. There's a fellow who says, I have a testimony. I should. Should I have beer in my cart? Should I go walking through the grocery store with a bottle of wine? Think about that. Now let's see what the Bible says. It's not a matter what you think or what I think. What does the Bible say? What does God say about it? Is God silent? Well, let's see what the Bible says. Notice Proverbs 20 and verse 1. Wine is a mocker. Strong drink is raging. And whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Deceived means misled into error. It means cheated. So it says wine here is a mocker. It's a scorner. It's a mimicker. Okay? And it can be deceiving. It'll lead you into error. Okay? And this is that's Proverbs 20, verse 1. Look over a couple chapters of Proverbs 23. And by the way, it says if you're deceived thereby, you're not wise. Okay? The opposite of wise is you are foolish. Foolish. Proverbs 23. Proverbs 23, notice verse number 29. Who hath woe? Who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? Who hath babbling? Who hath wounds without cause? Who hath redness of eyes? Here's your answer. They that tarry long at the wine, they that go to seek mixed wine. Look not thou upon the wine when it is red, when it giveth his color in the cup, when it moveth itself aright. At the last it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder. He's saying in verse 29, who babbles on and doesn't know what they're saying? Who is it that has woes? Who has sorrows? Who gets into contention? Some guys get very contentious when they're drunk and they pick fights. Others, who hath wounds without cause? You wake up and you got wounds and cuts. You don't know how they got there. I don't know how that happened. Who hath redness of eyes? So he says, don't look at the wine when it's red, when it gives its color in the cup, when it moves itself aright. When it moves itself aright, it's fermented. And he says, don't even look at it. I don't think he means close your eyes and drink it. Okay? I don't think that's what he had in mind. Because he says, at the last, it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder. Thine eyes shall behold strange women. Thine heart shall utter perverse things. Yea, thou shalt be as he that lieth down in the midst of the sea, or as he that lieth upon the top of a mast. You're saying you're going to be like in the middle of the boat or on top of the mast, and everything's moving around you. I told you before, I tasted a beer once. A relative gave me a taste of beer and I spit it out. It tastes awful to me. If I was not a Christian, I still probably would not be a beer drinker. I don't like the taste of it. But I've never been drunk. Don't know what that's talking about. I've listened to people who have told me what it was about. And Brother Wallace said, I mean, they told me that It's like that. I mean, and don't raise your hands, but some of you have been who've had that in your past. You know, they say, you know, I just want the room to stop spinning. You know what I mean? Just want everything to stop moving. That's what he's describing here. As you hug the toilet. They have stricken me, shall they say, and I was not sick. They have beaten me and I felt it not. And you can get things can happen to you and you don't even feel it. You're completely out. And then he says, when shall I awake? It's like I'm in a bad dream. I mean, you're sick. You're said bad things. You're around the wrong people. You got all kinds of problems. You can't stop the room from shaking. Your eyes are red. You feel sick. And yet it says, what happens? When shall I awake? What's the last words of the verse? I'll seek it yet again. Sometimes you see people go through things like that and you say, man, they'll probably never drink again. And you know what? You find out the next week they're back at it. I just go back at it again. The Levites. Look back in your Bible to your left to Leviticus chapter 10. Will you please? Leviticus chapter 10, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. Third book of the Bible. Leviticus 10. Leviticus 10, God gives some instruction here to Aaron. Aaron was the priesthood. His sons and descendants, they would be those who served God and did the work in the tabernacle and later for the temple. The Lord spake unto Aaron, verse 8, saying, here's what you do, Aaron. Do not drink wine nor strong drink, thou nor thy sons with thee. When you go into the tabernacle of the congregation, lest ye die. And it shall be a statute forever throughout your generations. And that ye may put a difference between the holy and the unholy, and between the unclean and the clean. So here's the priests that are going to do the work of God, that are going to come to the presence of God. And God says, you are not going to touch, you're not going to drink any wine or strong drink. Now let me ask you a question. That was for those Old Testament priests. You tell me, who are the New Testament priests? Believers are. We don't have to go to someone else to go to God on our behalf. We all have access to God. That's why the Bible calls us, we're believer priests. We all have equal access to God. Every single person here can come boldly to the throne of grace. As I said before, I'm happy to pray with you. I'm happy to pray for you. But I don't have any more access to God than you do. We all are equal when it comes to the throne of grace. And so every believer is a priest of God. So I believe priests, believers, ought to totally abstain from alcohol. It has no place in the life of a Christian. Thank you. Three of us think that's a good thing. Let me give you some statistics. You can write these anywhere you want. You might have them on the back of your paper if you want. In 2014, that's the most recent I could find. Are you ready for this now? 2014, 87.6, almost 88% of people 18 and older have reported that they have drank alcohol some point in their lifetime. You realize that 9 out of 10 people you see when you walk in through the store, or you walk in through the world, 9 out of 10 people have had a drink of alcohol sometime in their life. 71%, 7 out of 10 say they've drank in the last year. 57% said they've been drunk in the last month. 6 out of 10. 25% of ages 18 and older reported they engaged in binge drinking in the last month. And 6.7% said they engaged in heavy drinking in the last month. Are you ready for this? Each year, 88,000 people die from alcohol-related causes. It's the fourth leading preventable cause of death in the United States. Over 10,000 people die every year on the highway because of drunk driving. Misuse of alcohol. They have to open up rehabilitation centers and trying to correct things in different government programs. cost the United States $249 billion in 2010, most recent statistics I could find. 40% of the prisoners, of state prisoners convicted of violent crimes, were under the influence of alcohol at the time of their offense. In 2000, that's 16 years ago, U.S. agencies surpassed the $100 billion a day barrier in spending to incarcerate individuals with serious addiction problems. That's why President Obama was trying to release guys from prison who had drug problems. And he has. He's put them back out on the street again. He said, "What? Why don't we do something about alcohol?" Here's why we don't do something about alcohol. Because alcohol netted almost $198 billion with a B in sales in 2014. That's 9.4 billion gallons of alcohol. The government took in over $10 billion in taxes on it. That's why they don't want to do anything about it. Because they're making money on it. Now, I want you to go to an Old Testament book of Habakkuk. The old-time preacher called it Habakkuk. Remember Ian Paisley from Ireland called it Habakkuk. But it's Habakkuk, as we call it. Chapter 2. It's in the Minor Prophets. I think it's right before Zephaniah. It's right after Nahum, I think. Notice verse number 15 of Habakkuk chapter 2. Woe unto him. Are you there? Okay, you there? If you're not there yet, just stop at whatever page you're on and look intelligently at it, okay? And it'll be all right. Chapter 2, verse 15. Woe unto him that giveth his neighbor drink, that putteth thy bottle to him, and makest him drunken also, that thou mayest look on their nakedness. It's amazing how many times in the Bible that alcoholism is connected with nakedness, immorality, and wrongdoing. Now I want you to think, in fact, you know what? It's never mentioned in a good light anywhere in the Bible. You say, now wait a minute, preacher. John chapter 2. Jesus turned water into... Every drunk knows it. You talk to anybody about alcohol, they'll bring it up to you. They know two verses. They know Jesus turned water into wine, and they know that Timothy had to take wine for his stomach's sake. They know those two verses. How many agree? You've had that happen to you. I'm sure you have. You're shaking your head. Now, I want to ask you something. Knowing what you know from Proverbs 20... Wine is a mocker, strong days raging. Notice, you know, from Proverbs 23, look not on the wine when it moves itself in the cup. Knowing what you know from Habakkuk 2, don't put a bottle to your neighbor's lips. Well, you know from Leviticus, the priests are not to drink any wine or strong drink. You think Jesus is going to go against all those scriptures and make wine in John chapter 2? No. Listen carefully. The living Word of God will not contradict the written Word of God. The living Word of God will not contradict the written Word of God. I don't have to tear apart in John 2. It's okay if you do. If you want to tear apart and use Greek words and all that, that's fine if you want to, but you don't have to. Because it's very plain from the Old Testament, Jesus isn't going to violate that. So what he turned that into, there was no word for grape juice, and so it's all called wine in the context, you know, of what kind of wine it was. And it was grape juice. It was fruit of the vine. All right? So it's never presented a good light in the Bible at all. There ought to be none in the Christian's life. Not in your house. Not of any part of it whatsoever. I wouldn't go to a party where they're serving it. I'm not gonna go sit in a bar and drink a Coke while someone else has a alcoholic drink. I'm not going to be a part of that. If that's why if I broke down and had to make a phone call. And, of course, we have cell phones now, but I sure wouldn't go into the liquor store to make a phone call. I would sit beside the road and pray and ask God to send somebody by before I do that. I just won't do it. So I think total abstinence is right and it's biblical, and I think it's absolutely in line with the will of God according to the Bible. Okay? Number two in your paper tonight is drugs. Revelation 21 and verse 8, the last book of the Bible, Revelation 21 and verse 8. Get to the back of the book. Revelation 21 and verse 8. Bible here lists some people who will not be in heaven. He says, but the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. The word sorcerers there. The word sorcerers is the word pharmakai. We get our word pharmacy from it. It's interesting how drugs and the occult go together. And listen, it's no surprise as we get further from God in our society that we move to this drug epidemic that we're in the middle of. We have a heroin epidemic in our country. You heard me tell you Sunday, just in Ohio. And you know they had one in New Hampshire and they have one in other states. Heroin is a real problem. Over 214,000 deaths in Ohio, or over 240,000, I'm sorry, deaths in Ohio last year from heroin overdose. That's just Ohio. That's 200 every month. Just yesterday talking with my sisters, there's been 20 in one high school up in northeastern Ohio. Drug overdose deaths. They're beside themselves. Don't know what to do. Hey, listen, if they just would stop and think, hey, listen, wait a minute. What got us here? What decisions have we made that have brought us to this kind of a society? Where we don't even know what bathroom to use. How far have we come? How far have we gone? We can't even have any sense. It's unbelievable. So you have to be careful. Drugs and occult go together. And by the way, whether it's illegal drugs or prescription drugs. 80% of heroin users started with prescription drugs. The doctors have to bear some of this blame. Because, and by the way, we bought in this other thing, and that is this, that because as soon as you go to the doctor and anything that's wrong at all, what do? Write your prescription. Go get this filled. Take this pill. The average American has 18 prescription and non-prescription medicines in their medicine cabinet tonight. So every one of you knows somebody who's a little older, up in years, and they've got so many pills they lay out every night, you can't even keep track of how many there are. Someone usually has to come and help them and put them in a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday little container so they know what to take every day. And we are medicated to death. Because here's the false premise. We think, I should never have any pain. But the Bible says pain can be good. Don't think that just because you have pain, oh no, I got to take something. I shouldn't be in pain. That's what you'll hear when you're in the hospital. That's what you hear when you go to the doctor. Oh no, I don't want you any pain. We'll give you something for that. I got news for you. Life can be painful. But I look back on life and having lived a few years now, I'm going to tell you something. I learned more through the painful times than I did the happy times. Pain was good. And that song, More Love to Thee, O Christ, More Love to Thee, the verse says, send grief and pain. These are thy messengers. Sweet their refrain. Who prays for that? Who prays for God to send them grief and pain so they can learn some things that God wants them to learn? Paul had a thorn in the flesh. Now he asked God to remove it, and what did God say? My grace will be. My strength is made perfect in weakness. You'll rely upon me because you have that, Paul. And so God left him with the pain. So be careful what you allow into your body. If you allow drugs, prescription or not prescription, listen, you can be opening yourself up to demonic oppression and not realize it. Think about this. We have more drugs, more hospitals, more doctors, and more sick people than ever before. One thing that can be certain when you come up to any city you haven't been in for a while, and I know, like Brother Steve, you're in and out of Columbus sometime. I tell you what you can go and see what changes every time you come here. You know what it is? Hospitals. Bigger. They're always building, always expanding. Yesterday, we waited an hour and a half after my mom had a heart catheterization, and they put a stent in her and had to get a room in ICU. They waited because they had to get a bed. You've been through that. Why? They're full. You got to get somebody out so they can move somebody in. Just incredible. So drugs becomes an issue. Don't listen. The goal. I realize sometimes you have certain situations where you may have to take something, you're diabetic, or you're on, you know, things like that. I understand that. But your goal and my goal ought to be that we don't have any drugs in our system. That would be the goal. And ask God to help. Oh, so some people, we convince ourselves we can't live without this. You know what that thought is? That's the thought of an addict. I can't live without this. And I've had people say, oh, I got to have something to go to sleep. Well, doesn't the Bible say he gives his beloved sleep? Well, that's the Bible. Yeah, it's the Bible. I'm not minimizing people who have a difficult time sleeping. I'm saying, why don't you ask God to help you with that? And when you have difficulty sleeping, maybe when you take it as, hey, God must want me to pray. And just begin to pray for whatever God puts on your heart. And pray. So I had somebody tell me, I told somebody that one time, and they said, well, I do that, I fall asleep. That's what you wanted, wasn't it? You see? But you didn't have to take a pill to do it. Okay, let's go number three. Number three. Stop the clock. Number three, tobacco. Tobacco, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Are you okay? Huh? Oh, isn't this great? Don't you like studying the Bible? I know these aren't real pleasant topics, but I'll tell you. Listen, some of you have been saved for years and years and years, and you know what? This is the first time you've ever been in a church that has addressed any of these topics. I've had people come and say, man, I never knew the Bible said anything about that. And they've been in church for 7, 8, 10 years, 12 years. But no one ever taught them about what the Bible says about these issues. Aren't you glad you're one of the ones who knew what the Bible says about it? And if you say, well, I'm not coming back here, well, you heard it when you're here, didn't you? Tobacco, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Verse number 19. What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Back just a few chapters in chapter 3, he kind of reiterates the same thing. He says, if any man, well, look at verse 16. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. If I defile God's temple, God can destroy me. In fact, he may allow what I'm using to defile my temple to destroy me. And when you smoke, your testimony goes up in smoke. Tobacco and the nicotine that's in the tobacco is a drug. That's why you crave it. But it hurts your body and it hinders your testimony. Remember Dr. Coral, Evangelist Dennis Coral, talking about after he was a bouncer in a bar when he got saved. He stopped drinking, but he didn't stop smoking. But he'll never forget, he said, I was witnessing to a friend trying to tell him about Jesus, and he said, the friend said to me, don't tell me about Jesus when you're sucking on that weed. He said, I threw that out. He said, and I quit then and there. Never had another one. I knew it hindered my testimony. He said, I wanted to be an effective witness for Jesus Christ. And I know I wouldn't be able to witness for Christ if I'm smoking a cigarette. We could talk about the money it burns up as well. I've mentioned my brother, and I've told you this before. I think that when he found out he had pancreatic cancer, and boy, the smoking stopped and the drinking stopped just like that. And that first month that there was no alcohol and no cigarettes in the home, his wife said, we saw $400 more dollars a month in our account that was going out on alcohol and cigarettes. That's a lot of money. That's almost $5,000 a year. Multiply that over 20 years. Yeah. Loss of testimony. It defiles the body. It grieves the Holy Spirit. It shortens your life. And whether you smoke it or whether you chew it, it's wrong. It has no place in the life of a Christian. Ask God to take it away from you. Ask God to take it away from you. How many of you have asked the Lord to help you and you've quit smoking since you've become a Christian? Let me see your hand. Look at that. Look at that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. There you go. 13, 14. There are a lot. Don't say you can't do it. No, you're right. You can't do it. But God will certainly help you do it. Jesus came to save you from your sins. Let him save you from your sins. Okay? Number four. This is the last one, by the way. It's an hour long, but it's the last one. Okay. Number four. Let's put, you ready? Television and movies. The air goes out of the room. Psalm 101. We've been here before. Psalm 101. What's Psalm 101, church? The TV song. See, there's a psalm in the Bible about television? Yeah, there is. You should look at it. Psalm 101. Job said in Job 31:1, he said, I've made a covenant with my eyes. Why should I look upon a maid? That's what Job said. But I want you to look at Psalm 101. David said, notice in verse number 2, I will behave myself wisely in a perfect way. O, when wilt thou come unto me? I will walk where? Within my house with a perfect heart. Where's he walking? Where now? In his house. Oh, he's gotten inside where we live, huh? In his house, he says, verse 3, I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. Of course, there's no wicked things on television. We don't see anything wicked there, do we? What about, I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. Nothing on TV make you turn aside from following Christ, is there? No, it's all good. What about verse 4? A froward heart shall depart from me. I will not know a wicked person. A froward heart is a heart that doesn't comply to what it's being asked to do. Someone is a froward heart for God. I don't want to do what God wants me to do. Okay? Of course, there's no one like that on television, is there? Wicked, a wicked person? It's amazing. we wouldn't allow, we wouldn't ever associate with some of the people that we let come into our living room on a regular basis. Whoso, verse 5, privily slandereth his neighbor, him will I cut off. Anybody slander anybody on TV? He that hath a high look and a proud heart will I not suffer. There's nobody, there's no proud people on TV, is there? Nothing to do with pride. Mine eye shall be upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. He that walketh in a perfect way, he shall serve me. That's who David says, I want to watch. How about this one? Verse 7. He that worketh deceit shall not dwell within my house. There's no deceitful things on TV, is there? It says, that guy's deceitful, he's not staying in my house. He that telleth lies shall not tarry in my sight. We don't watch any programs where they lie, do we? Here's what you should do. I will early destroy all the wicked of the land, that I may cut off all wicked doers from the city of the Lord. You know what you do if you can't handle that and you can't control what you watch? Cut it off. Don't need it. You absolutely don't need it. In other words, I'm not going to look at something that's going to cause me to move away from God. I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes that will not cleave to me. And can I tell you this? If I watch it and I notice it, it will cleave to me. You ever been around somebody and something happened to them, or they got hurt, or something hit them, or they hit something and they let something out of their mouth that wasn't good? They say, oh, don't know where that came from. I do. Yeah, it came from your heart, because you let it in through here or through here. And what we see goes into our heart. In fact, Lamentations, and we're going to come to this a little bit later, it said, mine eye affecteth my heart. I'll say more about that in just a minute. Don't watch things that do not please Christ. I told people in 5:30 class on Sunday, the Christian growth class, you know, occasionally when I come over to someone's house, you see them, trying to put something over here or hide this underneath this thing. You know it is, preacher, you know. And I think, wait a minute. You don't want me to see it. Who do you think is seeing it? Jesus is seeing it. When you look at something you shouldn't look at, who's right there with you? Jesus Christ. Why do we do that? We lose the awareness that he's right there. Kids can be arguing or having words, and this probably never happened in your family, Miss Richardson, but in case the girls ever did something like that, you know, and then you poke your head around the corner and say, is there a problem in here? Anything I can help you with? And all of a sudden, hey, we're good, Mom. Everything's good here. Nothing going on. Her presence changed things. When we're aware of the presence of Christ, it changes things. We have to be aware that he's there. And you ought to be aware whenever you're watching something, am I comfortable if Jesus Christ were sitting right here with me? Because he is. He is. Psalm 119, verse 37 talks about, I'm almost there, I'll read it to you. Psalm 119, verse 37 says, turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity, emptiness, nothingness, because mine eye affects my heart. What I see with my eye is stored in my heart. You won't forget it. It's there. You can delete pictures off your phone, but you cannot delete them off your heart. They're there forever. And as a man, Proverbs 23:7, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. That's how you'll be. That's why he told Solomon, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Luke 11 and verse 34, the light of the body is the eye. And so if I'm going to be full of light, I have to let the light in. Or I can let the darkness in. The light is the things of God. God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. The darkness are the things of the world. And it's no wonder that when we spend Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday letting all the darkness of the world in, we come to church Wednesday night and we think, is he ever going to get done? You know why? Because you don't want any light. You got so much darkness in you, the light can't penetrate it. You will so much more enjoy Sunday and Wednesday when you let light in through the week. His light, once more light. And you'll enjoy that. So you ask her, you need to set a standard about what you'll watch and what you won't watch. Harry Potter's not, is that letting the light in or the darkness? The Walking Dead and Hunger Games. Light in or darkness? I would name some other primetime stuff, but I don't know what they are. Those might be outdated, I don't know, but you get the idea. But we saturate our mind and our heart with ungodliness and wickedness and worldliness and immorality, then I wonder why I'm dead to godliness and holiness. Why I'm dead to the things of God. Why church and the people of church, they're just boring. Because I filled my life with the wrong stuff. I've been in, and by the way, this goes for movies. One time in my life, I went inside a movie theater. We weren't permitted to go when I was growing up, and I didn't go. One time I went, and as I told you before, I learned as a teenager, I won't get away with anything. God always had somebody there who'd tell my parents. Well, it worked. And I haven't gone, I don't go to the movie theater. So he said, oh, have you seen that movie? No, I haven't. I don't intend to. But whether you go to the movie or you, now you don't even have to go there. You stream it right into your house. But the standard ought to remain the same. The standard ought to remain the same. I don't have any desire to see what Hollywood has to offer. I don't. It has no draw for me whatsoever. Philippians 4:8. You ought to put that on your television set. Write out that verse. Things that are pure and things that are true and honest and lovely and just, a good report. There be any virtue and there be any praise, think on these things. Mine eye affects my heart. The last I checked, I'm supposed to love the Lord thy God with all my heart. My heart's supposed to belong to Him. Remember, I'm not my own. I've been bought with a price. I belong to God. Therefore, I'm to glorify God. I'm to put God in a good light. I'm to, as we learned in RU, glory means make look good. Make God look good with the way I live my life. That's what these things do. You say, man, if I do that, Pastor, the world's going to think I'm a weirdo. That's right. They'll think it's strange that you don't run along the same course as they do. But I'm going to tell you what. The course of this world gets old. And at some point, the devil's going to chew them up and spit them out. And they'll come to somebody who is different and say, I'm ready to listen to what you have to say. You stick with it. Now, next week, we're going to talk about separation in our music. I want you girls to come back next week. That's the kind of music you need in your life. Music you need in your home. Distinctively Christian. There is Christian music and there's music that is not Christian. So we'll get into that a little bit next week. And you'll look forward to that, I'm sure. All right? Let's stand together for prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. And Lord, we thank you for your word and for the plainness of the Bible as it discusses these things and lets us know, Lord, what's right and what's not right. Lord, I pray that tonight you have spoken to hearts. I realize, Lord, there's all different people at all different places in their life here this evening, in their Christian walk. For some, this was the first time they've ever heard anything like this. Others have not heard it in a long time. But Lord, I pray that all of us would examine our hearts and say, God, I want to live the rest of my time to the will of God, not to the will of the flesh. That we'll desire to please you. And that as a girl sang tonight, that you will be the reason we live. And what a reason it is. Thank you so much for a good service here this evening, Lord. It sure was good to be in the house of the Lord this evening. Dismiss us now with your care and make us mindful of your presence as we leave this place. Help us to be about your business this week. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Well, let's sing Higher Ground. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Got it? Let's hear you sing. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. God bless you. You are dismissed.